Good evening.
Good evening.
We welcome you here at the North Fork Community United Church of Christ to our Ash Wednesday service. And this Lenten journey, friends, is a process. It is a commitment, a labor of love. And what we must do is to be prepared for the resurrection. That's what this is about. We must wait for it with penitent hearts. With ashes, we are marked to remind us of our mortality, to remind us of our desperate need of God's eternal life. With dust, we are sealed into the ground from which we came, but from that same ground, that empty tomb, comes new life, but not yet. We must wait in prayer. We must wait in penitence. We must wait in patience. The resurrection is coming, but not yet. We must prepare. We must wait. First comes the journey to which Christ calls us. Come, let us begin on this Ash Wednesday together as the body of Christ, this Lenten journey. We are going to sing our first hymn, that beautiful hymn that Kim taught us a few weeks back, Thy Word is a Lamp Unto My Feet. Let's stand for that, please.
Please join me in the responsive reading.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
O my inmost being.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
And forget not all his benefits.
Who forgives all your sins.
And heals all your diseases.
Who redeems your life from the pit.
And crowns you with kindness.
Who satisfies you with good things.
So that you are renewed.
The Lord works righteousness and justice for the oppressed.
The Lord is gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in love.
He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay our sins.
As high as the heavens are above us, so great is his love for us.
As far as the east is from the west, he has removed our sins from us.
As far as compassion on his children, God has compassion on us.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
Thank you. That's great. So we're going to do the prayer of confession in unison. That's printed on the screen. We can follow along as we obviously put our hearts into the right posture before God, because that's what our whole evening is going to be about, and the posture of our hearts. So let's bow our heads, close our eyes, and say these words that are, well, if you are closing your eyes, you cannot follow along. But maybe you memorized it. Who memorized it? Okay. But you know what I mean. All right. As disciples of Jesus Christ, we are called to struggle against everything that leads us away from the love of God and neighbor. Repentance, fasting, prayer, study, and works of love help us return to that love. Let us therefore commit ourselves to love God and neighbor by confessing our sin and by asking God for strength to persevere in our Lenten discipline. Amen. So as you were coming in, you received in a little bag, you received your own ashes for applying the anointing oil and the ashes on your forehead or your hand, wherever you choose to place it. And let's do that right now together as the body of Christ, as a sign of repentance. Let's bow our heads and pray together. Lord God, just this last Sunday, we experienced the joy that the disciples felt on that mountaintop with Jesus when they were witnessing his conversation with Moses and Elijah. The glory of Jesus was revealed to them, and we think of that event as Jesus having changed, but in the process, they, the disciples, were changed. And now we are in a completely different position. And this is representing darkness and night, the unknown of the future and what it will bring. Tonight we will hear words that will chill our spirits. We will receive the mark of the ashes. We have received them. That reminds us of the sacrifice and commitment we are about to make for the journey. Forgive us for our fears and our hesitancy. Lord, we pray that you heal our inner person. Enable us to enter into this time of learning and testing with great courage and deep trust. And we ask all these things, Lord, humbly in the name of Jesus. Amen. What can I do to fix this microphone? Am I doing something wrong? Okay, so I'm going to handle this issue then. What we are about to do is we're going to look into the scriptures, Leviticus 16, 29 through 34. And before we do that, why don't we stand, look around at someone, and give them a smile under your mask. Let's stand up, loosen up a little bit, because I'm afraid you're going to fall asleep later. So it's been a long day. Smile at the person next to you. Some of you have come from work, and you have done other things. You've been busy. Just smile and put your hand on your heart and tell the person that you're praying for them. That's great. Good to see you guys. And good to have you back. All right. Okay, so you may be seated, and we are going to look at Leviticus 16, 29 through 34. And you can follow along on the screen, and please don't close your eyes. This shall be a perpetual statute for you, so that in the seventh month, on the 10th day of the month, you shall humble yourselves and do no work of any kind, whether it is the native citizen or the stranger who sojourns among you. For on that day, the priest shall make atonement for you to cleanse you, so that you may be clean from all your sins before the Lord. It shall be a Sabbath, a solemn rest for you. Everybody say, solemn rest. And you shall humble yourselves. It is a perpetual statute. The priest who is anointed and consecrated to minister as a priest in the place of his father shall make atonement and shall put on the linen garments the holy garments, and he shall make atonement for the holy sanctuary, for the tent of meeting, and for the altar, and he shall make atonement for the priests and for all the people of the congregation. This shall be a perpetual statute for you to make atonement for the children of Israel for all their sins once a year, and Moses did as the Lord commanded him. And I think in another translation I just read that Moses did everything as the Lord commanded him to do. So if you permit, let's join together and go on a brief journey this evening regarding this word repentance. And you know, if there is ever a time where we're supposed to talk about it, it's Ash Wednesday. It is on Ash Wednesday that we use this word, that we focus on this word. Thank you for putting up that slide. And it is in the Bible that we are supposed to repent. It is this passage that we just read out of Leviticus that is truly a beautiful one. It's almost like a pearl hidden in a bunch of other treasures, but it's the pearl of great price, like we read in the New Testament, that is given to the people, to God's people. That's you and me. It was in the days of Israel, to the Israelites as a nation. It was given to an entire nation. Imagine that they were under God's governance. They were under God's leadership and under his blessing, and they're receiving this gift from God. And this gift is that they would once a year repent, that they would correct, that they would fix, that they would focus on the posture of their heart. And we're going to look at several parallel scriptures, and most of them are in the New Testament this evening, that talk to us about this same message. It's the same reminder that God is giving to his people. He's giving it to us this evening individually. You have come from different walks of life. You have come from a different experience today. And you have your story with God. You have a story with God. And within that story, this requirement, this command that God is giving us to regularly, look at our hearts and where are we at in our relationship with Him and with one another is key. The first one I'm going to look at with you are two verses from Revelation chapter 2. And we're going to start out with verse 5, and then we're going to go back to verse 4, because that's the one that sends down chills one's spine when you read that sentence, because it's so sobering. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. So, and then verse 4, the one before that, is the one that is so chilling and that is such a sobering reminder. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. And I remember reading the scripture many times. As a matter of fact, the first 6 chapters of the book of Revelation was mandatory translation for us from the Greek into the Hungarian at seminary. And so when you read these passages, they're so familiar because you remember how you had to translate it. And you remember the professor standing there and telling you why we're translating it the way we do. But there's this one word, remember. It's very significant. Tonight we're asked to think about that first encounter that we had with God. In your heart, think back of that time. When it went on, this light on the inside of you, where you realized that God personally cares for you, that God personally loves you, that God personally died for your sins on the cross. This moment, we should all have it. This moment where it becomes real big to us what Jesus has done. So that's what Revelation chapter 2 verse says. Remember. It's very significant. Think about it. Ponder upon it. And the definition of repentance in the Old Testament, the first word is naham, in the Hebrew, which means to turn around or to change the mind. That's a hard one, isn't it? I like how that's worded, to change the mind, your mind, my mind. Have you said that to someone lately? I've changed my mind. I had to change my mind. Don't look at anyone right now. Must you always distract me? No, I'm just kidding. I always know what to count on, or who to count on. All right. And then the second word is sub. It is used over 600 times in the Old Testament and is translated by such words as turn, return, seek, and restore. We all like to be restored. You know, when you've been broken on the inside and you get restored, isn't that a wonderful feeling? Or when you can tell someone that there is a hope, there is a restoration. It's okay, it's going to be better. You're helping them to be restored. You're helping them to seek the answer from God. You're helping them to return to God and to turn. And I think that's what this evening is truly about. I mean, it's one thing, you know, to put the ashes on our forehead and to say that prayer of confession that we said, and we actually said 2 today. We said one in unison, and then I prayed one separately. But we all know that unless it somehow, touches our hearts and the inside of us, it's nothing more than just a ritual. And as a matter of fact, it's a pretty, pretty clean ritual. I'm looking for the word. What's the word? What is it? Sterile. That's the word I was looking for. It's a pretty sterile Ash Wednesday. You know, we have everything. You've got everything in a bag. you could do it yourself. You had the anointing oil be put in there. And then the people give, they're so nice. They even prepared these for you so that we can be very sterile and that we can clean our hands before. And obviously, when we're talking about sitting in ashes and making our hands dirty with the shame of what it means to have turned away from God, then that's obviously a far cry from it. But we're doing that to keep you safe and to keep you comfortable. Are you comfortable tonight? Well, it's going to get uncomfortable. I've gotten uncomfortable in preparation for this message because I said, Lord, you're saying this to me. I know you're saying it to me. And then the Greek word metanoia is in the New Testament. It means to change your mind. That's what fundamentally repentance truly means. And here's a beautiful interpretation by a theologian that was given to me how they view repentance. Repentance is a decisive change in direction. In other words, you were going south and now you're going north. It's decisive. It's visible. Everybody can tell. And then it says it's a change of mind that leads to a change of thinking. That makes sense, doesn't it? When you change your mind, that will influence the way how you think. Think about God. Think about people. Think about how God views you and how God views people. And that leads to a change of attitude. And that's true, too. If God changes our hearts, then our attitudes will change. From a sour, bitter attitude to a loving and kind attitude. And from an attitude that lists the wrongs of others to say, Lord, I'm just like that too. Can you say that? You know, sometimes when we point at others, when we reflect on the inside, when I reflect, I can't speak for you, but when I reflect on the inside, I say, well, Lord, I'm just like that myself. I can be that way. I can say those things. I can act that way. And so repentance means that God leads you from, you know, you think differently in the process. Your attitude changes. Your feelings change towards other people. And your values change. And in the process, it leads you to lead your life in a different way. And that's, again, another thing that Ash Wednesday is about. It's about leading our lives differently. And, you know, I'm just going to make it real personal. Because, you know, there's no point in me saying all these things if it isn't personal. I can make it personal for you, but I can make it personal for me. I have noticed about myself lately that I have been acting and saying and talking in ways that I haven't talked like that since I was in the world. Since I was without Jesus. And all of a sudden I looked in the mirror and I said, Attila, I don't like who you are turning into. I don't like to talk like that. I don't like to act like that. I don't like to think like that. But here it is. In my humanness, I do. In my fallen nature, I do. And so I'm in desperate need of God. That's what Ash Wednesday is reminding us when we repent of our personal sins. So the first passage from Revelation that I was reading to you about was written to the church in Ephesus. And the scary part is when you read through these letters that were written to the churches in Revelation, they no longer exist. They're gone. They used to be, but they're no longer. And it makes me wonder, no, it doesn't make me wonder, you put two and two together, and it equals that they did not return to their first love. They did not go back to their first works, but they just kind of stayed where they were at. Attila just kind of stayed where he was at. And therefore, the church, those churches today no longer exists. Some of you were in their ruins. There could be a church today there. There are other churches that are very old, and they still do exist. So if I take God's word serious, then I put myself into Ephesus. I put myself into Sardis and say, okay, Lord, is this about me? Am I like that? So let's go to the next scripture, which is Revelation 3, 2 through 4. Wake up, strengthen what little remains, for even what is left is almost dead. Now, if that's not an indictment, I don't know what is. If that's not an indictment that you have left your first love, I don't know what is. Because we don't want to leave our first love, do we? It's a terrible thought. It gives you the chills to think, what? I don't love Jesus like I used to? Or like I should? That puts us into tears, doesn't it? So then it says, I find that your actions do not meet the requirements of my God. And you know, what really got me was when you go to Revelation chapter 2, if you have your Bibles with you, why don't you? Revelation chapter 2, look, it's all printed in red. So let me read to you the beginning verses of Revelation 2. To the angel of the assembly of Ephesus, write. So Jesus is dictating a letter. That gives us the chills, doesn't it? That Jesus is writing a letter to the church at Ephesus, and he's saying, you know, your behavior does not meet the requirements of my God. Go back to what you heard and believe at first. Hold to it firmly. What's firmly? No, that's not firmly. That's firmly. Right? That means I'm not letting go because my life depends on it. This is the water of life. I'm holding on to it firmly. I don't want to be like that. I want to be like Jesus. Like Jesus acts, like he speaks, like he treats other people. And I fail. I'm not always like that. Are you? Don't get quiet on me now. Because that's us. It's our human nature that gets us away from God. And this is an indictment to me, and I'm not speaking for anybody else, but it's an indictment for me, and I'm taking it. I'm rather saying, Lord, you're speaking to me, and I want to change, than to pretend like I'm all okay, because I'm not. That's not going to help me or anybody. Repent and turn to me, and here's the word, look at it, again. Again. Do it again. And again. And again. And again. All the time. You have to do it. I have to do it. We do that all the time. Again and again. If you don't wake up, I will come to you suddenly as unexpected as a thief. Yet there are some in the church in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes with evil. They will walk with me in white, for they are worthy. Wow, how powerful is that? It says there is a remnant. I have had a sister in Christ that I've been praying with regularly say to me repeatedly, Pastor, fear not, little flock, because it has pleased your heavenly Father to give you the kingdom. Do you feel sometimes like you are a little flock? Do you feel in the minority? Do you feel, why bother, why try? I tell you why, because we want to have Jesus smile at us and not shed tears over us, right? That's what it's about when you read these words of repentance. You know, blessed Ash Wednesday, yeah, sure. Till I walk out of here and it's, you know, it's all right. You know, you might be going to the store. I'll be going to the store after this. Pastor, you go to the store? Yes, I do. I have nobody else to go for me to go to the store, so I go to the store. And, you know, when you do that, they're going to see the mark on your forehead and somebody asks you what it's about, tell them. I don't want to leave my first love. I want to stay with my first love. All right. So Jesus is writing this. He is speaking these words to the church at Sardis, to us personally, to any church in Northport, to any church around the globe. And who of us here can say with a sincere heart that since our conversion, we have always remained on the highest flame level? Or who could claim that they have never cooled off in their love with God? You know, sometimes it's easy to go through the motions. And I've promised myself one thing, that if I ever get to the point where I just go through the motions, I'll pack my bags and I'm done. Because you cannot do this. Either you do that and you pay the price somewhere else, or you man up and woman up and say, Jesus is everything. Remember what that little boy said who was blind? He wants to see Jesus. And the king wanted to hear probably, well, don't you want to see the king too? Right? And the little boy said, no, Jesus will do. I know, that just touched me because it's the simplicity of the gospel. So God is seeking a basic heart attitude from us, and he's seeking it consistently. It's regular inventory. Our staff here does that. Our office manager and our office assistant and Mike, they do take inventory. They go into our, you know, whatever, the rooms where they store stuff, and they say, well, we need more of this, we need more of that. That's taking inventory, isn't it? To take inventory consistently, regularly. And that's what Leviticus is all about. Isn't that amazing that God gave them a day and he said to a whole nation, that would be like God stepping into America and say, once a year, and we're just going to take, it's going to be, Church Day. National Church Day. And on National Church Day, we're all going to come to rest in God. We're going to all humble ourselves. We're all going to repent. And it's not emotion, it's an action. Does that sound wild to you? It doesn't sound like anything. It's wild. To me, it's wild. Because I'm thinking, wow, it's an entire day, once a year, just for that? Just for that. And then what did the priest do? He brought an atoning sacrifice for the sins of the people and for himself, and they came together as an entire assembly. But it meant the individual as well. Revelation 2:15 through 16. Likewise, you also have those who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Repent, therefore, otherwise I will soon come to and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. Wow. I mean, these are just tough scriptures, one after another. And you really can't complain. In 6 years, I've never preached a message like this. Not once have I preached like this. But, you know, if it's Ash Wednesday, it's got to be about that. It's got to be about having it really, it's real. It has to be real. So, who were these Nicolaitans? Well, there's all kinds of ideas about that, but the main thing is they were a group of people that were trying others not to follow Jesus. How would you like someone like that in the church? You know, somebody would join and say, oh, I no longer want you guys to follow Jesus. That's wild, isn't it? That's really wild. And so here were this group of people, and Jesus is saying, you know, some have went with them, but some didn't. But if this doesn't stop, I will come and I will fight against them. Jesus is saying this with the sword of my mouth. What does that mean? Who can help me out? I'm theologically illiterate. With the word of God. With the word of God. Because they were teaching false stuff, and Jesus is going to come with the word of God and he's going to correct it. He's going to preach the true word of God. The whole thing. To ask ourselves, okay, so then let's go to 2 Corinthians. It's only 7:34. 2 Corinthians 7:9-10. Now I am glad I sent it, not because I hurt you, but because the pain caused you to repent and change your ways. It was the kind of sorrow God wants his people to have. So you were not harmed by us in any way, for the kind of sorrow God wants us to experience leads us away from sin and results in salvation. There's no regret for that kind of sorrow, but worldly sorrow, which lacks repentance, results in spiritual death. So what he's saying here is, I'm addressing a difficult issue, but I know you got upset about it. I know you were sad over it, but that sadness led you to turn back to God. You know, if I know in my own heart that I am distant from God, that I have cooled off in my relationship with him, that it isn't what it used to be or that it isn't what it should be, then if that makes me sad, well, then that's a good thing, isn't it? Because if it makes us sad, that it means then we're going to turn around. We're going to change it. We're going to invest into it. So to ask ourselves, have I fallen asleep spiritually? Am I on the wrong path? Have I left my first love? Are good questions to ask on Ash Wednesday. And then people say, let's look at 2 Timothy 2:23 through 26. Again, I say, don't get involved in foolish, ignorant arguments that only start fights. And then here's a guideline of what we're supposed to be like as Christians. As a servant of the Lord, we must not quarrel, but must be kind to everyone. Be able to teach and be patient with difficult people. Gently instruct those who oppose the truth. Perhaps God will change those people's hearts and they will learn the truth. Then they will come to their senses and escape from the devil's trap, for they have been held captive by him to do whatever he wants. So to translate that, it simply means that the devil doesn't want us to come to repentance. The devil doesn't want us to be sorry for a cooled-down relationship with him. And I'm glad we have Ash Wednesday once a year. Because once a year we are reminded of the tremendous price that had to be paid before we could be forgiven. Isn't that the beautiful scripture in Romans where it says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still in a big mess, God lifted us out. There's a wonderful praise and worship song. Maybe Kim knows it. He lifted me out of the miry clay. That's one of the lines in that song. He lifted me out of what I couldn't get out of myself. You know, that dilemma that we are in. So the devil does not want us to. But if we do repent, then individually and as a community, whether that's a city, a land, a country, a church, a neighborhood, it will blossom. There's going to be freedom. There's going to be truth and love. So as we read Leviticus today, God is ready to bless us. Because you see, intricately, repentance and blessing are connected. If I repent, God will bless. If I turn to him, he will turn to us. So Revelation is a tough book. Who's going home and reading it? Oh, I tell you, I was like, man, Lord, what are you saying? John 13, and this is going to be so familiar because Jesus lived it for us. He's our example. He's the one that we go by. Now, before the Passover feast, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Now, supper being concluded, the devil had put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he came from God and was going to God, rose from supper. So Jesus is getting up from supper. Laid aside his garments and took a towel and wrapped himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was wrapped. Then he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, "Lord, are you washing my feet?" Jesus answered him, "You do not understand what I'm doing now, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "If I do not wash you, you have no part with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Don't you just like him? It's like, okay, not just my feet, and everything. Jesus said to him, "He who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. You are clean, but not all of you." For he knew who would betray him. Therefore, he said, "Not all of you are clean." So when he had washed their feet and put on his garments and sat down again, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord. You speak accurately, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example," let's say example, "that you should do as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." And I never noticed this before, but these two passages, this passage and the passage about the Lord's Supper, are almost identical. Isn't that what Jesus said? "Do this in remembrance of me." And here he says the same thing. If you know these things, do them. Jeanette, where are you? Jeanette is from a tradition, the Church of God. She shared with us in our coffee hour on Monday how they don't have Ash Wednesday service, they don't have Monday Thursday service, but they do have a foot washing service. You remember growing up in that. It's kind of like the Lord's Supper. Do this. I'm doing that. And so I am going to finish with this because I know you're all zoning out on me. I'll be gone from the pulpit real quick. When you wash someone's feet, that takes humility, doesn't it? I think it does. For you to kneel down, wrap that thing around you, take the person's feet, wash it. It takes humility to do that. And then you look at the person that's sitting there and having their feet washed and you think, well, they're the king. Because even that takes humility, doesn't it? It takes a lot of humility to do that. So what we're doing is we're saying, "Lord, I do fall away. Lord, I do not always do my first works. Lord, I do turn away from that first love that has captivated me in those first moments when I first saw you, when I first experienced you." We're going to hear a testimony next week about somebody having an experience with Jesus. I look forward to that. But, you know, looking back and we say, "Lord, we just mess up. We need to have our feet washed." So repentance means to humble oneself and to confess to God, "I'm not walking in a manner like you have it laid out for me." Since as individuals or as a community, we're not walking in God's ways consistently, according to Leviticus and according to what we read in Revelation, we should consistently practice repentance and a repentive act. Repentance belongs where individuals, just take this home with you because that's what I'm going to take home. Repentance belongs where individuals want to stand in a healthy relationship with God. That's the nutshell. The two go together. If I want a healthy relationship with God, I just have to repent of my wrong ways and say, "Lord, you are right, I'm wrong," and that settles it. So Ash Wednesday is truly a super chance for us to turn to God and say, "Have your way, Jesus, with us." And I have to admit, it's not easy. It's hard. But it's much harder not to. Let's stand and pray together. Lord God, as we get ready for the special music that's been prepared for us, we just pray that you use the words of that song, of the music, to minister to your people today. I thank you for everyone who is here. I thank you that you're working in our lives, and I thank you that your word is true no matter what. In the name of Jesus, we pray it. Amen. You may be seated. Received your Lenten study guide or study book. So that is going to begin next Wednesday at 6 o'clock to study, and as you can tell, it has topics like the desperate father and the uncertainty of faith, Peter and the uncertainty of forgiveness, the crowd and the uncertainty of worry, Lazarus and the uncertainty of mortality, Zacchaeus and the uncertainty of surrender, Jesus and the uncertainty of obedience, and finally, the empty tomb and the proof of the resurrection. Great study. Bring it with you next week, and why don't you already at home look at the first one, the first chapter. Let's receive the benediction. Let's stand for that, please. Go as those marked as God's beloved. Look at those you meet and remember each one is also God's beloved. Go knowing your days on earth are numbered. Make the most of each day, You are given by showing kindness and fighting for justice. Go to embark on this Lenten journey. Go where God sends you to do God's work. Amen. Stay safe. God bless.